Hello, my dear students. The property depends on is the number of solute particles. Non-volatile means the solute particles will not vaporize. It will not go to the vapor phase. It is also called as Rolle's law of relative lowering of vapor pressure. To understand this better, we'll see the graph as well. Hello, my dear students. Welcome back to the fifth session on the chapter Solutions. Last class, we had studied about ideal and non-ideal solution and about azeotropes. Today, we shall learn about colligative properties. What do you mean by colligative properties? The property of a solution which depends only on the number of solute particles. What is it? Number of solute particles, but not on the nature of the solute particle, is called as colligative property. So what is this? The property depends only on the number, how many solute particles are present. It is not dependent on the nature of the solute particles. The solute particles can be atoms, ions or molecules. That will not be considered. The only thing the property depends on is the number of solute particles. Such properties, we call them as colligative properties. We have four colligative properties to learn. That is, relative lowering of vapor pressure, elevation of boiling point, depression of freezing point, and about osmotic pressure. Okay, so this colligative properties, especially for dilute solution where solute is non-volatile. Okay, the solute is non-volatile and it is for dilute solutions. Okay, so we learn the first one, that is relative lowering of vapor pressure. So what do you mean by relative lowering of vapor pressure? First, I shall take an example. For example, I have solvent, only the pure solvent is present. Some of the particles from the solvent, that is the liquid, will escape and go to the vapor phase, and they will exert some pressure on the surface, which we call it as vapor pressure of the pure solvent, only because solvent is there. Now, for this solvent, I shall add some amount of non-volatile solute. Non-volatile means the solute particles will not vaporize. It will not go to the vapor phase. Okay. So, when I add non-volatile solute particles, now these solute particles will come on the surface and prevent the escaping of the solvent particles from the solution. So it will cover the surface area for the solvent particles to go to the vapor phase is reduced, because of which the number of vapor particles, you can see, it is much lesser. That is because you have added a non-volatile solute, because of which even the vapor pressure also will reduce. Okay, so the difference in vapor pressure after adding a non-volatile solute is called as lowering of vapor pressure. Okay, so we'll see, when a non-volatile solute is dissolved in a volatile solvent, the vapor pressure of the solvent decreases. Why it decreases? Because the non-volatile solute particles is on the surface and it will not allow the solvent particles to escape. They are covering the surface. Thus, solvent particles cannot escape into the vapor form. Okay, so the vapor pressure of the solution is always lower than the vapor pressure of the pure solvent. Thus, the difference in vapor pressure of the pure solvent, if I consider P1 naught is the vapor pressure of the pure solvent. So this is P1 naught, okay, and the solution is P1. For this, after adding non-volatile solute, if the vapor pressure, if I consider as P1, then the difference in them, that is P1 naught minus P1, is called as delta P, which is called as lowering of vapor pressure. It is what? Lowering of vapor pressure. But what am I learning? I am learning about relative lowering of vapor pressure. What do you mean by relative lowering of vapor pressure then? That is, the ratio of lowering of vapor pressure to the vapor pressure of the pure solvent is called as relative lowering of vapor pressure. So you take the lowering of vapor pressure by the vapor pressure of pure solvent. This ratio is called as relative lowering of vapor pressure. So I hope you understood what do you mean by relative lowering of vapor pressure. Next, according to Rolle's law, at given temperature, the relative lowering of vapor pressure of a solution is equal to the mole fraction of the solute. So if first one, what I have written is solvent, and two subscript I have written for solute. Okay, so here what does Rolle's law tell? Relative lowering of vapor pressure, I'll write it here once again, P1 naught minus P1 by P1 naught is equal to mole fraction of the solute. That's why X2 I have written. Okay, now what is mole fraction of solute? It is number of moles of solute by number of moles of solvent plus solute. So it is equal to N2 by N1 plus N2. So this relation is also called as Rolle's law of relative lowering of vapor pressure. It's also called as Rolle's law of relative lowering of vapor pressure. Okay. Why exactly it is called like that? From Rolle's law, what do you get? If P1 is the partial pressure of the component 1, it is directly proportional to the mole fraction. Now to remove this, we are putting P1 naught X1, that is partial pressure of the pure solvent, correct? Now here, if I consider P1 is equal to P1 naught, X1 is 1 minus X2, because X1 plus X2 is equal to 1 in binary solutions, correct? So X1 I can also write it as 1 minus X2. Here P1 is equal to P1 naught minus P1 naught X2. Now take this on the other side, I will get it as P1 naught X2 is equal to P1 naught minus P1, and X2 is equal to P1 naught minus P1 by P1 naught. This is exactly what I have written here. P1 naught minus P1 by P1 naught is equal to X2. So that is why this relation is also called as Rolle's law of relative lowering of vapor pressure. Okay. Going further, I told you that the colligative properties is for dilute solutions. That means the solute particles are much lesser. So in the denominator, we have N1 plus N2. Among this N1 and N2, that is number of moles of solute and the solvent, number of moles of solute is very, very less compared to the number of moles of solvent. So we are going to write this N1 plus N2 is approximately N1. So what I have written, N1 plus N2 is approximately equal to N1. So the relation will become relative lowering of vapor pressure is equal to number of moles of solute by number of moles of solvent. Now what is the number of moles of solute? Mass of the solute by molecular mass. What is the number of moles of solvent? Mass of the solvent by molecular mass. So M is molecular mass, W is mass. Okay, so if I rearrange that, I will get it as W2 by M2 into, this will go to the numerator, M1 by W1. Okay, so this is the relation which we need to calculate the molecular mass if they ask in our numericals. So numericals, we'll solve it in the coming sessions. Okay, so what is W1? It is mass of the solvent. M1 is molecular mass of the solvent. M2 is molecular mass of the solute. W2 is mass of the solute. And this is relative lowering of vapor pressure. So I hope you understood about relative lowering of vapor pressure. Next we have elevation of boiling point. When do you call the temperature as boiling point temperature of a particular liquid? That is when the vapor pressure of the liquid become equal to the atmospheric pressure at a particular temperature. That temperature is called as boiling point. To understand it better, I've taken a liquid here. Okay, let me consider it to be water. I'm heating it. Okay, with the Bunsen burner. Here I have got water particles. There's a thermometer which is attached here, okay, which is dipped into it. Of course, I'm not showing any stands, etc. And it is also covered. Okay, it is covered. Now, I'll start heating it. It's at a room temperature. Now, I'll start heating it. The temperature also will go on rising. At one point of time where the vapors which is formed by water, okay, there are vapor particles and they will be having some vapor pressure also. So the vapor pressure, when it becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure, okay, and at this happens at a particular temperature which is called as boiling point. I hope you understood. At one particular temperature, when you're heating, the vapor pressure becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure and you can observe that the water starts boiling. At that temperature is called as boiling point of water, which is 100 degrees Celsius at sea level. Correct? Now, for the same water, I've added some solute. What is it? I've added some solute particles. Okay. Now, when solute particles are added at the surface, some of the solute particles will come and they will cover the surface. And these solute particles are non-volatile as well. It is non-volatile. Correct? Now, what happens is this is covering the surface and not allowing the particles which is below it to escape. So the solvent particles now cannot escape very easily because the surface area has reduced. Now if I boil such solutions, what will happen is a little higher temperature is required for the vapor pressure to become equal to the atmospheric pressure. Okay, so there is always elevation, increase in boiling point when a non-volatile solute is added into the solvent to form a solution. Okay, so I hope you understood the concept. Once again, we'll see here. A liquid boils at a temperature at which the vapor pressure is equal to the atmospheric pressure. I told you the vapor pressure should be equal to the atmospheric pressure. In solution, the non-volatile solute particles, what does it do? It obstructs the escaping of the solvent molecules from the surface. Thus, vapor pressure of the solution will be reduced. I told you there will be an obstruction. They will be covering, or the surface area for the solvent particles to escape as reduced because of the presence of non-volatile solute particles. Okay. In order to make the solution boil, its vapor pressure must be increased by raising the temperature above the boiling temperature of the pure solvent. Thus, the boiling point of the solution is always higher than that of the boiling point of the pure solvent in which the solution is prepared. So, to To understand this better, we'll see the graph as well. Here, in this graph, what do we have? We have temperature in the x-axis and vapor pressure in the y-axis. Okay. Now, here, if you observe, if I take the pure solvent, at some temperature, they have a particular vapor pressure. Now, as the temperature increases, the vapor pressure of the solvent also increased. At a point, this point, where the vapor pressure is equal to 1 atmosphere, that is our atmospheric pressure, and that temperature is called as TB0, is the boiling point of the pure solvent. Okay. Now, I have added some amount of solute particles, non-volatile solute particles, to form a solution. Now, solution has a particular vapor pressure at a particular temperature. As the temperatures increase, the vapor pressure of the solution also goes on increasing. At the point where the vapor pressure of the solution is equal to the 1 atmospheric pressure, that temperature is called as TB, that is boiling point of the solution. Now, difference in the boiling point of the pure solvent and the solution is called as delta TB. Okay, so we'll see here, let TB not be the boiling point of pure solvent. TB is the boiling point of solution. The increase in boiling point, delta TB is equal to TB minus TB0, is known as elevation of boiling point. Okay, so elevation of boiling point from experiments, we know it is directly proportional to molality. So it is proportional to molality. To remove the proportionality, we put the constant KB, which is called as boiling point elevation constant or molal elevation constant, or it can also be called as ebullioscopic constant. It has got three names. Okay, KB is also called as boiling point elevation constant or molal elevation constant or ebullioscopic constant. Okay, and the unit of KB is Kelvin kg per mole. Now, what do you mean by molality? Number of moles of solute in 1 kg of solvent. So, the molal elevation constant KB will become equal to elevation of boiling point when molality is equal to 1. That is, 1 mole of the solute when it's dissolved in 1 kg of the solvent. Okay. Now, molality, how can I express? I can write it as number of moles of solute. How do I get number of moles of solute if M is molality? Number of moles of solute is mass of the solute by molecular mass and mass of the solvent in kg. Correct, no? So, if it is 1 kg, directly 1. If it is in grams, then it should be mass of the solvent by 1000 to convert into kg. So, if I rearrange this, I'll get it like this. That is W2 by M2 divided by W1 by 1000 it is, which I can write it as W2 by M2 by W1 and 1000 goes to the numerator like this. So, this is molality. Now, molality if I put in this formula, okay, then I'll get it as delta TB is equal to KB into 1000 into W2 by M2 into W1. So, if they ask you to find out the delta TB, then you are using this formula. But if they ask you to find out the molecular mass of the solvent, then M2 what is there, you take it on to the left hand side, delta TB you get to the denominator and you will get this formula. So, any one equation if you all remember, that is sufficient to solve all your numericals. Okay, so that is about elevation of boiling point. Next we have depression of freezing point. What do you mean by freezing point? Freezing point is a temperature at which the vapor pressure of a substance in the solid phase is equal to the vapor pressure of the same substance in the liquid phase. What is it? Vapor pressure of solid phase is equal to vapor pressure of liquid phase for the same substance. That temperature we call it as freezing point. Okay, now according to Rolle's law, when non-volatile solute is added to a solvent, the vapor pressure of the solution decreases. Correct? The vapor pressure will decrease because there is obstruction which is created by the non-volatile solute particles, because of which the vapor pressure is decreased. We already learnt about it. Now, the solution will freeze. I'm talking about the solution now. Solution will freeze when its vapor pressure equals to the vapor pressure of the pure solid solvent. So, when a non-volatile solute is added to the solvent to form the solution, then vapor pressure of the solution should become equal to vapor pressure of pure solid solvent at a temperature which is called as freezing point of that solution. It is observed that freezing point of the solution after adding the non-volatile solute will always be less. That is, after the solution formation, the freezing point will be lesser than the original freezing point of that particular pure solvent. Okay. To understand this better, we'll see with the graph. In this graph, we have temperature on the x-axis and vapor pressure on the y-axis. Correct? Here you can see, first we have the solvent which is in the liquid state. As the temperature is reducing, see, I want to find out the freezing point, so I'm coming this way in my axis. So whenever I'm reducing the temperature, the vapor pressure of the liquid also went on reducing. At one point where you can see, at this particular point, this solvent is in the liquid state, this vapor pressure, okay, and this is the vapor pressure of the frozen solvent. When both became equal at this temperature, we call it as TF naught. Okay, now I've added the solute particles to that particular solvent to form a solution. Now, the vapor pressure was like this. As the temperature went on reducing, the vapor pressure also reduced, and the vapor pressure of the solution became equal to the vapor pressure of the solvent at this particular temperature, which is called as TF. Okay. Now, difference in the temperature of the pure solvent and that of the solution is called as delta TF. Here you can see, let TF not be the freezing point of the pure solvent and TF be the freezing point of the non-volatile solute dissolved in it. Okay, so delta TF is equal to TF naught minus TF. The decrease in freezing point is known as depression in freezing point. Okay, temperature is lesser, so it is depression in freezing point. It's also observed that delta TF is directly proportional to molality. To remove the proportionality, we put a constant called as KF. KF is called as freezing point depression constant or molar depression constant or cryoscopic constant. This cryoscopic constant will be equal to the depression in freezing point when the molality of the solution is 1. okay? That is, 1 mole of solute is dissolved in 1 kg of the solvent, okay? So, the unit of Kf is same as Kb, that is Kelvin kg per mole. If W2 mass of the solute having the molar mass as M2 is present in W1 grams of solvent, then produces a depression of freezing point of delta Tf, then the molality of the solution can be given as M2 by W1 by 1000. Now this one, if I put in the equation above, I'll get it as delta Tf is equal to Kf into W2 by M2 by W1 by 1000, which if I rearrange it properly, I'll get it as W2 by M2 by W1 and 1000 in the numerator to Kf. If I want to find the molecular mass, I have to take it this end. This will come over here. So, I'll get M2 is equal to Kf into W2 into 1000 by delta Tf into W1. So, you need these formulas for the numericals, which I shall solve in the coming sessions. Okay, that's about depression in freezing point. Next we have the value of Kf and Kb can be determined using the equation. So these are the equations to calculate the value of Kf and Kb, that is ebullioscopic constant and cryoscopic constant. So here you have R into M1 by Tf square by 1000 into delta H fusion. That is because it is freezing, fusion of ice we have to take. Kb is equal to R into M1 by Tb square by 1000 into delta H vaporization. So, R is gas constant we know, M1 is molar mass of the solvent, and delta H vaporization is enthalpy of vaporization of the solvent. Delta H fusion is enthalpy of fusion of the solvent. So it is dependent on the solvent here to calculate Kb and Kf. We do not have anything which is related to the solute in this equations if you have observed. So that is about the formulas to calculate Kb and Kf. So, I hope you have understood today's class. Next class, we'll be learning about osmotic pressure, Van't Hoff's factor, and we'll be solving some of the numericals. I hope today's class you have understood. See you next class. Stay tuned. Stay focused, my dear children.